Do you remember the first time you went to an aquarium as a kid, wondering about what sea life you'd get to experience? If you were anything like I was, then you might have been excited to see the shark exhibit, and perhaps hoping for a great white. You would have discovered, however, that they don't keep great white sharks in aquariums. These sharks don't seem to fare very well in captivity, and you know, there are already many great videos discussing why that is. So why did I make this video? Well, I want to take a look at it from a slightly different angle. The thing is, these discoveries were largely made by trial and error. A lot of errors. Many tried to keep great whites in aquariums, and I want to take a look at what happened to the sharks themselves. So today, we're going to take a look at what happened to the great white sharks that were put in aquariums. Let's go back to the 1950s to California, to the largest oceanarium in the world at the time, Marineland of the Pacific. First opened in 1954, a year before Disneyland, Marineland of the Pacific was a big deal at the time, designed by the architect William Pereira, the man who worked on LAX and the Giselle Library, among other things. There were parts of the aquarium where people could go snorkeling in the tank with a bunch of fish and marine life. And although it wasn't the first to have captive orcas, it was famous for the two orcas they had. Even though today we know having captive orcas is really not a good thing. If you've seen some older television shows like The $6 Million Man, The Munsters, or The Partridge Family, you might have seen Marineland of the Pacific as it featured in these and many other TV shows at the time. The park went through different owners, including Hanna-Barbera and SeaWorld, before finally closing in 1987. Though the park was used to film movies after it closed. But jumping back to 1955, 1 year after the park was opened, they attempted to keep a great white shark, a fairly small one, about 1.4 meters or 4.6 feet. Now, if any facility at the time was capable of housing this baby great white, you'd think it'd be this one. Well, you'd be wrong, as the shark was dead in less than 24 hours. 5 years later, they tried again in 1960. You might think that after 5 years, they might be more successful the second time around. And they were. This great white lived for almost 2 days. In the same year, another aquarium tried to hold a great white shark, the Waikiki Aquarium, which opened in 1904, making it the second oldest still operating aquarium in the US, the first being the New York Aquarium. And in 1960, they got their great white, and they went big, with a 4 meter or 13 foot great white. Not close to the max size, but a substantial shark nonetheless. But this big shark didn't go so well either, and died within a few days. In 1962, Marineland of Florida, considered the first oceanarium, also tried to hold a 2.4 meter, 8 foot great white, and it died within a day and a half. A few years later, in 1968, a few other countries tried to figure out captive great whites. An aquarium in South Africa made an attempt, but the shark only survived a day. That same year in Australia, though, another aquarium would try their hand and be surprisingly successful. Let me tell you about the shark that defied all odds. This white shark had been caught on a hook and line, but fought for hours before it was eventually dragged onto the beach. The Manly Marine World Aquarium came to get him, and they put him in a tank on the back of a pickup truck. The tank had no filters, by the way, and drove for 45 minutes to the aquarium. When they got him to the aquarium, they took him out of the water, put him onto a stretcher, and carried him up multiple flights of stairs, and then chucked this 2.4 meter, 8 foot shark into a cramped tank that was already full of turtles, nurse sharks, and other fish. And somehow, after all that, this guy managed to survive. And not only that, he swam around the tank without any issues, and on the third day, he even started to feed. The problem was, this guy preferred to eat his tank mates rather than the fish offered by divers. He even started to go for the divers, and when things got too dicey, it was decided the shark had to go. Well, they could return him to the ocean, right? They didn't really have the right equipment, but if they got him there, maybe they could try and bring him back. Well, they didn't decide to do that. Instead, they decided to just shoot the shark. They even sold tickets so people could come and see the show. 10 days after the shark that defied all odds was brought to the aquarium, divers armed with bank sticks shot the great white 7 times, and he sank to the bottom of the tank as the crowd cheered. I guess feelings towards sharks were a little different in 1968. Even though this shark had a violent and tragic end, the fact that it lived for 10 days and seemed to be doing fine gave a newfound confidence to aquariums around the world. Maybe you really could keep a great white in captivity. Spoilers, not really. Though there was a newfound confidence in keeping great whites, there wasn't necessarily a huge demand at the time. SeaWorld San Diego kept a 1.8 meter 6-foot male for 8 days in 1969. OceanWorld in Manly, Sydney kept a 1.3 meter shark for a day before it died in 74. The demand for great whites was about to spike though. In the mid 70s, a little summer movie was released called Jaws. The first summer blockbuster terrified people so much they didn't even want to go in the ocean, but they still wanted to see a great white, the monster from the movie. Even though sharks aren't really monsters, but whatever. People wanted to see these sharks from the comfort of dry land, and some aquariums were eager to please. And by please, I mean sell tickets. The race to get a viable white shark was on, and the place to get one, at least in the US, seemed to be California. A major player in the shark rush was SeaWorld San Diego, though no shark survived transport from 76 to 1980. But by 1980, SeaWorld had cargo trucks in the Bay Area ready to transport shark in temperature-controlled tanks with tranquilizing chemicals in the water and jets to keep the water flowing over the gills. SeaWorld weren't the only ones trying to get their hands on a white shark, though. Their main competitor was the SWAT Force, aka the Steinhardt White Acquisition Team of the Steinhardt Aquarium from San Francisco. They kept a SWAT force near the coast, ready for any potential shark. They also had a similar vehicle to the transport trucks that SeaWorld had. They called theirs the Elasmus Sarcophagus. This also created a bidding war between the two, SeaWorld offering $5,000 for a healthy white shark of the right size, and the right size was small. They both waited in hopes of being contacted by local fishermen who caught a white shark they could use. Of course, this was 14 years before great whites were a protected species in California, and with a bounty out, anyone who wanted to could try and get one. Many sharks died in the process of being captured, and sometimes whites were caught that were just too big, and after being refused by the aquariums, the sharks were left to die. The perfect white shark was caught, though, by accident, in Bodega Bay by a fisherman named Al Wilson. He decided to name the 7-foot female shark after his girlfriend, Sandy, though some sources say Sandy was actually his ex-wife. He first tried to contact the SeaWorld scouts, but when he called the hotel they were staying at, none of them were there. They had all decided to go out and do laundry at the same time. So instead, Wilson sold Sandy to Steinhardt Aquarium for $1,000. She made her debut on August 12, 1980, in Steinhardt's brand new 100,000-gallon donut-shaped tank. In just 4 days, 40,000 people came to see her. She made national news, Walter Cronkite of CBS Evening News even declaring her the darling of San Francisco. Unfortunately, Sandy wasn't doing so well in her new home. She avoided food, and a slight, small electrical current from the tank's power system messed with her navigation, and she kept banging against the glass. I've read that they had to keep the lights on in the aquarium at night because she was afraid of the dark, but I don't really know how you can determine if a shark is afraid of the dark. My guess is that she couldn't see without the lights and would bump into the sides even more, and that's why they left the lights on. But the bottom line was, Sandy wasn't doing well, and she most likely wouldn't survive much longer. The director of the aquarium, John McCosker, was becoming more and more worried about Sandy. The aquarium made the decision to remove Sandy and bring her back to the ocean 5 days later on August 17th. She was put back into the Elasmus sarcophagus and was driven over the Golden Gate Bridge with a full police escort. When they got to the water, Sandy was put in a sling that was attached to a boat and was led out to the Farallons. Once they released the sling, she swam away energetically, and hopefully she did okay. That same year, the marine land of the Pacific attempted to hold a great white. This time it was a shark that had been injured by a boat hook. It was kept for about 3 or 4 days before it was released. The following year, in 1981, they tried again and kept a small shark for just under a week. And what about SeaWorld of San Diego? Were they ever successful? Well, around the same time, they captured nearly 30 different white sharks and got the record of longest white shark living in captivity, 16 days. About 16 of the sharks were released, and I'm not sure what happened to the other 14 or so sharks, but I'm gonna guess they didn't make it. There are plenty more examples from aquariums with similar results. Either they had to release the shark after a few days, or it died. And there are probably even more attempts that I just didn't get to. There's also a specific, weird attempt at keeping two great white sharks in captivity from a little more recently. They weren't kept in an aquarium, though. In 2008, fishermen in the Mediterranean, off the coast of Turkey, captured two different white sharks and tried to display them in a 25-meter squared tank in a restaurant. I mean, I guess you could say it was a restaurant with an aquarium in it. I probably don't even need to tell you what happened. One shark died within 27 hours, and the other only made it to 12 hours before dying. It would be very difficult for these sharks to survive in a tank like this. I mean, it's tough for them to survive in a real aquarium. The great white shark is the largest predatory shark in the world, being able to grow over 20 feet. But they're not the biggest sharks. That title goes to the whale shark, of course. But the whale shark is housed in aquariums around the world with relative success. So why can't great whites thrive in these aquariums with larger tanks? Well, for one thing, even the biggest tanks might not be big enough. Great whites in the wild travel enormous distances. In the eastern Pacific, they regularly migrate from Mexico to Hawaii. Confined to a tank, the sharks can become easily depressed, and they also have navigation and eating problems, like with Sandy. Great whites have a hunting instinct too, and don't really like being fed by humans. He doesn't want to be fed, he wants to hunt. This is also a problem, as adult great whites feed on sea mammals like sea lions and seals. I'd imagine some visitors would become upset if they watched a live seal being eaten. Also, maintaining a supply of marine mammals for the shark or sharks to eat sounds like a challenge. It's also expensive. Apart from the gigantic tank, great whites have also been known to attack other sea life in the tank with them. It can get pretty costly if the great white decides to take a bite out of another creature on the exhibit. The water solution also has to be just right for the sharks to survive. Back in the day, before it was known white sharks were warm-blooded, they were often kept in water that was too hot for them. Given all this knowledge, though, has anyone been able to pull it off? Well, yes, sort of. I haven't yet mentioned the more successful attempts at keeping great white sharks alive. Enter Monterey Bay. They first made an attempt in the 80s, 1984, to keep a great white shark, but it only lasted 11 days. But through a later program named Project White Shark, they had greater success. Between 2004 and 2011, 6 different white sharks were displayed. The aquarium used a number of methods to ensure the success of the sharks. A 4 million gallon net pen was used to first give the sharks some time to recover after being captured. Then, a 3,200 US gallon, or 12,000 liter, portable tank was used to transport the shark so it could swim continuously while in transport. They also only took in smaller sharks, no more 3 to 4 meters. All their sharks were under 2 meters and displayed in the Ocean Open exhibit. These sharks were kept for a considerable length of time, some as long as 6 months, and none died while in captivity. There were still some issues though. Some sharks would have issues with feeding or navigating, and although no sharks died in the aquarium, some would die a few days, or in one case, a few minutes after release. Monterey Bay is the only aquarium in the world that successfully held a great white shark in captivity for a substantial length of time. On the Monterey website, it states that the main reason they kept the white sharks in the exhibit was to answer important research questions, and as those questions have been largely answered, they will not display any white sharks in the future. Since this was in 2011, I guess we haven't had any white sharks in the aquarium since then, right? Not quite. In 2016, a 3.5 meter, 11.5 feet shark was caught in a net off the coast of southwest Japan and brought to an Okinawa aquarium. He died within 3 days. Considering the cost and effort of displaying a great white, and most importantly, the risk to the shark itself, perhaps it's better not to make any future attempts. But what if we really want to see a great white shark? Well, maybe we could go to them. We could go cage diving and watch them in their natural habitat. Cage diving isn't controversial, right? Well, that's going to be the topic for the next video, and we're even going to have a special guest to help us answer that question. So make sure to subscribe if you want to see that. Anyway, thanks a lot for watching. I hope you have a great day.